Hello friends, and welcome to the lecture on the topic entitled Microbiology of Milk, Testing Quality of Milk and Milk Products. Let me give you a brief overview about the objectives of this lecture. Firstly, to get an insight into microbiology of milk, to understand about spoilage and processing of milk, to get an overview about the microbiology of some milk products, and lastly, to learn about the different testing methods for quality of milk. Firstly, the introduction. Raw milk is a complete food which contains proteins, fat, sugar, vitamins, and minerals. Cow's milk is the preferred choice for most people. It provides 67 kilocalories and has a protein content of 3.2 grams per 100 milliliters. Milk proteins include casein, about 80%, and whey, about 20%. Whey has a higher nutritional value than casein. Milk proteins have a high biological value, but unlike egg proteins, they lack sulfur-containing amino acids. The protein in cow milk have balanced amino acid profiles and good digestibility, making it the obvious choice when it comes to feeding the family. Casein in cow's milk combines with calcium to form caseinogen. Milk is a perishable commodity and spoils very easily. Its low acidity and high nutrient content makes it perfect breeding ground for bacteria, including those which cause food poisoning. Even though raw milk is sterile at secretion and contamination of milk by microorganisms can take place during milk handling, storage and other pre-processing activities. Bacteria from the animals, utensils, hands and insects may contaminate the milk and their destruction is the main reason for processing. Thus, preservation of the milk can be achieved by fermentation, heating, cooling, removal of water and by concentration or separation of components to produce foods such as butter or cheese. Now students, let's try to understand and learn about microbiology of milk. Firstly, the initial microflora, contamination from the udder. Although milk produced from the mammary glands of healthy animals is initially sterile, microorganisms are able to enter the udder through the teat duct opening. Gram-positive cocci, streptococci, staphylococci, and micrococci, lactic acid bacteria, Pseudomonas species, and yeast are most frequently found in milk, drawn aseptically from the udder. Diseased cows may also shed other human pathogens in their milk, including Mycobacterium bovis, Brucella abortus, Coxsella burnetii, Listeria monocytogenes, and Salmonella. Other sources of contamination. Milking equipment and bulk storage tanks have been shown to make a significant contribution to the psychotrophic microflora of raw milk, if not adequately sanitized. Firstly, exposure to inadequately cleaned equipment and contaminated air are also sources of contamination. Secondly, milk residues on surfaces and in joints and rubber seals can support the growth of psychotrophic gram-negative organisms such as Pseudomonas, Flavobacterium, Enterobacter, Chronobacter, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, Aeromonas, Acromobacter, and Alkaligenes. And gram-positive organisms such as Cornibacterium, Mycobacterium, Micrococcus, and spore-forming Bacillus and Clostridium. These organisms are readily removed by effective cleaning and disinfection, but they may build up as biofilms in poorly cleaned equipments. Milkstone, a mineral deposit, may also accumulate on inadequately cleaned surfaces, especially in hard water areas. Gram-positive cocci, some lactobacilli, and bacillus spores can colonize this material and are then protected from cleaning and disinfection. And lastly, other less significant sources of contamination include farm water supplies, farm workers and airborne microorganisms. Now dear students, let's try to understand the processing and its effect on the microflora. Firstly, raw milk transport and storage. In developed countries, raw milk on the farm is usually cooled quickly and stored in refrigerated bulk tanks at less than 7 degrees Celsius prior to collection. Temperature control is thus critical to minimize microbial growth. Bacterial numbers in the milk may increase during transport, either as a result of contamination from inadequately cleaned tankers or from the growth of psychotrophic organisms, particularly Pseudomonas species. The degree of growth is independent on the initial microbial load and the storage time and temperature. Pseudomonas are the predominant organisms present in stored raw milk, with Pseudomonas fluorescens, Pseudomonas fragi, and Pseudomonas ludensis being commonly isolated, but Enterobacteriaceae, Flavobacterium, Alkaligenes, and gram-positive species can also be found. Now, thermization. The most commonly used technique is to apply a mild heat treatment, that is thermization, by heating to around 57 to 68 degrees Celsius for 15 to 20 seconds and then cooling rapidly to less than 6 degrees Celsius. This reduces the psychotrophic population significantly and can extend the storage life of raw milk by several days. Now, deep pooling. As the storage temperature is a key factor for the rate of growth of psychotrophic spoilage organisms, storing milk at low temperature as possible can also extend the storage life significantly. Reducing the storage temperature from 6 degrees Celsius to 2 degrees Celsius has been shown to give a 2-day gain in storage life for milk of good microbiological quality. Now, carbon dioxide addition. There has been some interest in extending the storage life of raw milk by the addition of carbon dioxide at a concentration of 20 to 30 mm. Three mechanisms are thought to be involved in carbon dioxide inhibition of microorganisms. The first is by the displacement of oxygen. The second is the lowering of pH of milk due to dissolution of carbon dioxide and formation of carbonic acid, particularly from gram-negative psychotrophic aerobes. And the third is direct effect on the metabolisms, such as inhibiting the production of enzymes by these organisms. It has also been suggested that the technique could be used to extend the shelf life of pasteurized milk, but concerns have been raised that the use of carbon dioxide addition could allow growth and toxin production by psychotrophic Clostridium botulinum. Following storage, the milk then undergoes further processing, like separation, homogenization, pasteurization, ultra-heat treatment or sterilization processes. Now, dear students, let's get an insight into spoilage of milk by microorganisms. Firstly, pasteurized milk. Pasteurized milk provides a very suitable environment for microbial growth and is therefore highly susceptible to microbiological spoilage. Spoilage may result from either the growth of psychotrophic thermoduric organisms that survive pasteurization or post-pasteurization contamination by psychotrophs. The latter is considered to be by far the most common cause of spoilage. Thermoduric spoilage. The thermoduric microflora of milk consists largely of gram-positive spore formers, mainly Bacillus species. Clostridium and organisms with heat-resistant vegetative cells such as Micrococcus, Lactobacillus, Enterococcus, Streptococcus, Cornibacterium, and Alkaligenes. Of these, the spore formers are most important in spoilage since the other species are not generally psychotrophic and are unable to grow in refrigerated milk. Several Bacillus species contain psychotrophic strains, notably Bacillus cereus and Bacillus succulens, which may grow at temperature as low as 2 degrees Celsius. However, at slightly higher temperature, that is 7 to 8 degrees Celsius, Bacillus cereus in particular may grow quite rapidly, producing a type of spoilage known as bitter cream or sweet curdling, caused by the action of lecithinase on the phospholipids in fat globulins. Now, post-process contamination. The majority of post-processed contaminants are gram-negative bacteria, which may have some resistance to sanitizers and be able to colonize milk contact surfaces downstream of the pasteurizer. Initially, Enterobacteriaceae such as Enterobacter, Chronobacter, and Cytobacter predominate, but gram-negative psychotrophs, principally pseudomonads, but also alkaligenes, Klebsiella, Acetinobacter, and Flavobacterium are more important in terms of equal spoilage. Spoilage by gram-negative psychotrophs usually takes the form of off-livers, often described as unclean, fruity, rancid, or putrid, formed as a result of proteolytic and lipolytic activity. Yeast and mold are also indicators of post-process contamination. Their presence and growth contribute to fruity and yeasty flavors in milk. UHT or sterilized milk. Spoilage of UHT processed products is usually caused by post-process contamination. Spoilage caused by survival of heat-resistant bacillus spores is rare, unless very large number of spores are present initially, although reports of sterility failure caused by bacillus sporothermodurians are becoming more common. A particular problem associated with UHT processed milk is spoilage by heat-resistant extracellular proteolytic and lipolytic microbial enzymes. These will have been produced by psychotrophic organisms growing in the raw milk prior to processing, particularly pseudomonads, acetinobacter, and achromobacter, which are then able to survive the thermal process even though all viable cells have been destroyed. This was all about the microbiology of liquid milk. Now, dear students, let's now study about microbiology of other milk products. Firstly, concentrated and dried milk products. Concentrated and dried milk is produced for direct sale to the consumer, but are particularly important as food ingredients, providing a source of milk solids in a variety of other products. The removal of water from fresh milk gives advantages in terms of reduced storage and transport cost convenience in use, and in some cases, a useful extension to shelf life. The initial microflora of concentrated milk is that of the raw milk from which it is produced. Sugar used in sweetened condensed milk may be an additional source of yeasts and molds and bacterial spores, including thermophilic spores. Now, pathogens, their growth and survival. Concentrated milks are not normally regarded as high-risk products, principally because of the relatively severe heat treatments used in their manufacture. As with other pasteurized and UHT processed milks, the main concern for condensed and evaporated milk is post-heat treatment contamination by pathogens. Dried milks, however, are the subject of considerable concern, particularly in view of the widespread use in infant foods. There have been a number of outbreaks of foodborne disease associated with dried milk powders. Now, sweetened condensed milk. The sweetened condensed milks ensures that only osmophilic and osmotolerant organisms are able to grow. Cane products may be spoiled by slow growth of osmophilic yeast, particularly Torulopsis species, which enter the product after heating and may produce sufficient gas to cause blown canes. If sufficient oxygen is present in the headspace or the cane has a small pinhole leak, molds such as Aspergillus and Penicillium species may grow as buttons on the surface of the product. Condensed or evaporated milk. Firstly, Listeria species. The fate of Listeria monocytogenes has been studied in these products. The organisms decline during storage in sweetened condensed milk at 21 degrees Celsius, but the population remains stable at 7 degrees Celsius. In evaporated milk, growth was recorded at both temperatures. Now, Clostridium species. A study of incidence of Clostridia in sweetened condensed milk showed that about 40% of the samples contained greater than 100 CFU per 100 gram. These contaminants were identified mainly as Clostridium butyricum and Clostridium perfringens. Now, Staphylococcus aureus. Although there are no reported cases of foodborne disease associated with cane sweetened condensed milk, however, bulk products with much lower sugar contents might be at the risk if they become contaminated. Therefore, adequate hygiene is an important control for Staphylococcus aureus. About the dried milk. Although dried milk products have been implicated in a number of foodborne disease outbreaks, these have usually been the result of post-pasteurization contamination by pathogens. There have been several significant salmonellosis outbreaks associated with dried milk powders, and salmonella contamination has come to be regarded as a serious potential hazard in these products. Likewise, contamination of dried milk powders with staphylococcal enterotoxins was a significant problem in 1950s. Bacillus cereus has been found to be a common contaminant in dried milk. Chronobacter and Enterobacter species are not normally regarded as foodborne pathogens. But there have been a number of sporadic outbreaks of neonatal meningitis caused by Chronobacter, Enterobacter, Sakazaki associated with dried milk consumption with fatality rates as high as 30 to 80%. Now, let's discuss microbiology of another milk product, that is cream. Cream is defined as that part of cow's milk that is rich in fat and has been separated by skimming. Cream is often perceived as a luxury item, and therefore purchasing patterns are different from those that apply to milk. For this reason, the required shelf life is longer than for milk, and therefore, cream usually receives more severe heat processes than milk. And the post-heat treatment microbial population therefore consists almost entirely of relatively heat-resistant species. Aerobic spore-forming bacteria survive pasteurization, and psychotrophic strains of Bacillus cereus may cause sweet curdling and bitty cream. Other more heat-resistant species such as Bacillus lichenformis, Bacillus coagulans, and Bacillus subtilis may survive sterilization and even UHT processes and may cause bitterness and thinning in sterilized cream. Bacillus fumulus are now recognized as potential contaminants in cream, primarily carried over from raw milk. Butter. Butter is water in oil emulsion, typically consisting of at least 80% fat, 15 to 17% water, and 0.5 to 1% carbohydrate and protein. Butter is produced from cream, and cream is the main source of microorganisms in hygienically produced butter. Now, spoilage. Firstly, the bacterial spoilage. Modern hygienic manufacturing methods mean that bacterial spoilage of butter is much less common than that in the past. Surface taints may develop as a result of growth of Salmonella putrefactans and Pseudomonas putrefactans or Flavobacterium species. Such spoilage may be apparent within 7 to 10 days of chilled storage. Now, the fungal spoilage. Molds are still important spoilage organisms for butter, and mold growth may produce surface discoloration and taints. A number of genera have been associated with spoiled butter, including Penicillium, Aspergillus, Cladosporium, Mucor, Geotrichum, Alternaria, and Rhizophus. Now, the cheese. Cheese is a stabilized curd of milk solids produced by casein coagulation and entrapment of milk fat in the coagulum. It's divided into three basic types on the basis of moisture content. Firstly, the soft cheese, with high moisture content of 55 to 80%. Secondly, semi-soft cheese or semi-hard cheese with moderate moisture content of 41 to 55%. And lastly, the hard or low moisture cheese, that is 20 to 40% of moisture content. Now, the spoilage. Microbial spoilage of cheese can be caused by both bacteria and fungi, but the type of spoilage depends very much on the characteristics of individual cheese varieties. Firstly, the fungal spoilage. Molds commonly involved in cheese spoilage include members of genera Penicillium, Aspergillus, Cladosporium, Mucor, Fusarium, Monilia, and Alternaria. Effective hygiene is important in the control of mold spoilage in cheese, particularly in ripening rooms, and rigorous cleaning procedures are needed to prevent the accumulation of mold spores. Yeast may also proliferate on the surface of ripened cheese, especially if the surface becomes wet. Now, bacterial spoilage. In fresh cheese with a sufficiently high pH, such as cottage cheese, bacterial spoilage may occur. This is likely to be caused by gram-negative psychotrophic species such as Pseudomonads and some coliforms. Pseudomonas species, Alkaligen species, Acromobacter species, and Flavobacterium species are the psychotrophic bacteria of concern. It was all about the microbiology of milk and different milk products. Now, another important aspect of this lecture is microbiological tests of milk and its products. Various microbiological tests performed in dairy industry can be broadly categorized into the following groups. Firstly, direct enumeration of total bacterial count, that is, direct microscopic count. Secondly, estimation of number of viable bacterial cells, for example, standard plate count. Thirdly, assessing the microbial metabolic activities, for example, dye reduction test. And lastly, detection of specific contaminants, for example, coliforms and pathogens. Firstly, the direct microscopic count, DMC method. The DMC method enables rapid enumeration of bacterial cells along with their study of morphology of the total bacterial count in milk and cream with minimum equipment. It consists of examination of stained films of a measured volume of milk or milk products, that is 0.01 ml, spread over 1 cm square area and dried on a glass slide under microscope. Somatic cells, shapes, and arrangement of bacterial cells present in films can be easily and rapidly visualized and recorded. The microbial morphology and arrangement gives the clue to possible cause of high count, where high somatic cell indicates other infection, for example, mastitis. This technique is very useful for screening of milk supplies on receiving platform of a dairy plant, as well as for grading of milk. Now, standard plate count, SPC method. In this method, a known quantity of milk sample is diluted to known degree and equal portions of each dilution is poured into a Petri plate followed by addition of nutrient agar medium, a technique known as pour plate method. The organisms present in the sample are expected to be trapped in the agar gel. The plates are subsequently incubated at 37 degrees Celsius for 48 to 72 hours. In principle, each organism is expected to take up a separate position in the medium and grow into a mass of cells of a size sufficiently enough to be counted by naked eyes, recognized as a colony-forming unit or CFU. Hence, a colony count performed at this stage represents number of viable bacteria present in the given volume of milk sample. Now, dye reduction test. There are certain dyes which act as oxidation reduction indicator. Bacteria consume dissolved oxygen during their growth in milk and consequently reduce the OH to a level at which these dyes are reduced and get decolorized. Such dyes can be employed to assess the biochemical activity of bacteria and thus estimate number of bacteria indirectly. Now, methylene blue reduction MBR test. Methylene blue is a dye which remains blue in its oxidized state and turns colorless on its reduction. This characteristic is put to use for estimation of bacterial load of milk and milk products. Rhesus urine reduction test or RR test. Rhesus urine is also an OH indicator and hence is liable to be reduced by bacteria. Various colors developed sequentially during reduction of dye can be well compared with a standard rhesus urine disc with the help of a small apparatus known as rhesus urine comparator. Lastly, the coliform test. The coliform group of bacteria, Escherichia, Enterobacter, Klebsiella, include gram-negative non-spore-forming aerobic and facultative rods capable of fermenting lactose into lactic acid and gas. 1 ml of milk sample or decimal dilution is poured to a sterile plate followed by addition of 10 to 15 ml of violet red bile agar. Appearance of typically red colonies measuring about 0.5 mm is taken as positive test. Alternatively, fermentation tubes of 2% brilliant green lactose bile broth are inoculated with sample 1 ml and production of gas after incubation of 48 hours at 32 degrees Celsius is considered as positive indication for presence of coliforms in milk. This was all about today's lecture on microbiology of milk and its products. Hope you have understood them well. Thank you.